Happy Sabbath, everybody. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Now, for the effect, gentlemen, for the effect, can we have these window shades come down for just a moment here? I would like for you to recognize that you're at 385 East Dublin Granville Road, and that you're on television, but no one can see you except me and Carolyn and maybe a couple people here, but only the back. So thank you. Hello, everybody in Streamline Airedale land up there. Folks, we love you. If you're watching from wherever, we're happy that you're here. The announcements are on the board. You can see them. And now I will quickly do an ESPN two-minute drill with you here, okay? Number one, in your bulletin, it says, pray for the following people. If I could get somebody in the very back he's going to close the doors. That would be great in the very back. Thank you so much. Eva Gates is at the Laurels next to J. Lou restaurant. Wanda, her daughter, has asked that you call first now. It's at the point where call first before you visit. Call Wanda. And we pray for the Gates family a lot at this point, okay? Also, we're happy to see Linda Heisel back in church. And Beverly Paulson is feeling better. And Tambla, there's a phone number right here. And even if you don't know some of these people, it's okay to call them and say, I'm a member of the church. We belong together. And I don't know you, but I'm praying for you. Could I hear an amen for that?
Amen.
Thank you. You could be a visitor and do it. You could take this home and say, I've never been to this church in my life. And I'm going to call this person and say, because people need that. They need it. My friend Jean Newman that I take to church right down here, her brother went to sleep in the Lord this week. So she's thinking about that. So Jean, we pray for you and uplift your family at this time as well. Okay? Now we have some special announcements that are so special that I can't even make them because I'm just not special enough. First announcement from our wonderful kindergarten teacher at WAA, where we're having a great year, Carmi Ozunian, come and share with us, and then this will lead us into some other announcements that will be wonderful too. Carmi.
Good morning, church family. Next weekend is a big weekend for our church. We are having the Harding Hospital Centennial Celebration. We are going to have many visitors in our congregation, and I have been asked to head up our lunch for next Sabbath. Worthington Adventist Academy is funding this lunch. And the only thing that we are asking you as a congregation is to provide desserts. But I need other help also, because we are cooking for 250 people, and I do not have enough hours in the day to do that alone. So we're gonna send around two clipboards, one on each side. There are three areas of which you can help, and you can sign up more than once. I'm looking for volunteers Thursday evening from 6 to 8 to make lasagna for Sabbath. Then we are needing 16 volunteers to be in the kitchen. We are going to plate the food so that as people leave the sanctuary next Sabbath, they'll just go right through in a line, pick up their plate so that we can make it go as smoothly as possible. So I'm looking for 16 volunteers for that, a minimum. And then on the second page, we are looking for at least 25 families to provide a dessert that would serve at least 10 people. So check both sheets. Please sign up where you can. If you know somebody who's not here, if you are watching online and would like to help, please call me this week or call the church office. Thank you so much for all your help in making this next Sabbath a success. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. O. Now, I don't see my other announcement person today, but I will tell you that next week is going to be a very big week. And just before we have Dr. George Harding come up and share with us, I want to share with you that we are privileged that the Pathfinders and Adventure Club have been filled with someone. We announced it last week when some of you weren't there. Kwame, Tanya, Rob, Robert, and guess what? They have kids in both of these clubs, and they would like to do that and have you help them. So please, if you'd like to be interested in helping the Pathfinders or Adventures, I would be happy to have that. Today, we have a visitor, Thomas Bartlett, who is a member of our church already. I know you don't mind standing up and turning around. Let's give him a big hand. He's been here for 37 years. Let's give him a big hand. Please. Now, folks, when you have a chance to talk to this, did you hear what I just said, 37 years?
Yeah.
Now, is that a long time to come back to church? I mean, I'm telling you, we should be rejoicing and overjoyed by having this happen. I am.
He's,
and you are in Villa Angela Care Center on Coral Road. Anybody know where that is? And he is a wonderful man. He loves God. He loves people. And you know, he's reunited with his church family. But this is great. This is great. I mean, this is what we're all about. I can't be happier. I'm overjoyed to see you. Christian Strong, his shirt says. He's sitting in the second row. He hasn't been in church in 37 years. God bless you, brother. I'm so happy. And we'll have some times together. Oh, you're bringing tears to my eyes. And I'm telling you that. Thank you. Amen. So thank you. And just got to see Dr. George is right over there. You see him right over there a little bit later, too. He loves Dr. George.
A lot of people I have seen, but Bill Lindley, a lot of people I've seen in a lot of years.
Well, you know the best, Bill Lindley. I mean, he's awesome over there, too. Thank you, sir, for being here. Now, I'm going to tell you this, that when we talk about anniversaries, we have anniversaries all the time. Like, for instance, next Saturday, or I guess Friday or Saturday, it's going to be the 60th anniversary, wedding anniversary of BL and Eleanor Connect. Is that great? Now, they're not here. Are they here today? They're not. They were here first service. So they're even actually something at their home. So guys, let's really, really call them, visit them, email them. They're wonderful people, have done wonderful things in our community. Now, I'm going to tell you this, right over here at the organ, and right over here sitting down there with that flashy pink shirt over here, you know, only a real man would wear that nice pink shirt. James and Carolyn Sowers, 55 years today. Let's give them a big hand today, right here. Now, I'm not going to embarrass them, so that means I'm going to embarrass you. I'm going to say, Jim, isn't it just wonderful to be married 55 years to Carolyn? Isn't it wonderful? Look, Carolyn, everybody can see you. Has it been an overjoying experience to be married to your husband? Do these sound sincere? I think they do. So afterwards, just for a moment, make sure you come up and give them some love. I think 55 years is a wonderful amount of years. I hope that they have another 50 years to go. All right. Now, saying that, I'm going to invite Dr. George Harding to come up and give the announcement. But he's not going to say this, so I'm going to say it. This week, Dr. George and his wife celebrated their 64th year. Let's give them a big hand today. And now, Joe, Mrs. Harding, I'd like you to stand because I won't do this to you. I'd like you, come on, people need to see his better half. Okay, let's give her a big hand over there. That's right, thank you. Okay. Now, I'm going to have you do the announcement, and I'm still going to have you do the prayer in a little bit, but we want to do this announcement now because some people have to go, and I want them to hear, they stayed to hear this announcement, okay? So we're going to do it just a little differently, but you're still going to pray today a little bit later. So right now, let's listen closely to the announcement and stay close by down here when we do pray, okay? So go to your announcement now.
Well, we are very pleased that at long last, our Worthington Heritage Sabbath and the Harding Hospital 100th birthday are coming together this week. You know, just 100 years ago this Sabbath, the folks in the Columbus Seventh-day Adventist Church were busy as bees, because the Harding Hospital was founded as an outreach Seventh-day Adventist Church. My grandfather, George T. Harding II, was a member of that church. He had an office downtown on 3rd Street, and they felt that they needed a hospital here in Worthington where people with nervous and mental illnesses could come for help. And so the church banded together, worked all spring to find a place down in the university district, and to gather together a staff and a lot of volunteers. You know, it's a wonderful thing to be volunteers. And last week, you'll remember that Pastor Julian asked us to remember some of the people that have been members of this church and have moved to some distant place, or just haven't been coming recently for one reason or another. And he urged us to pick up the telephone, call them, and say, you know, on Sabbath, September 3, we're going to have a special Heritage Sabbath and Harding Hospital Centennial, and call and invite them. And not only invite them, you might say, I'll pick you up and you come with me, and we'll have a special dinner at noon that Carmi Ozunian is putting together. And we're going to have people coming from all over the country. You know, some people that have been members here in the past. And you'll get to see friends that you haven't seen for a long time. And you'll hear good music. Oh, yes, we're bringing Faith Esham here from New York City. Some of you have heard Faith Esham sing. She sings for the New York Opera Company and a graduate of Mount Vernon Academy. And she has sung here in the church with us before. And Carolyn Sowards has arranged for Faith to come and be a part of our special music, just a part, because we're going to have a number of special music events. Some people have said, We're disappointed we're not going to get to hear the praise singers, and that's right, because that's one of our treasures here, or the choir. But we're bringing in folks that I think you'll enjoy very much and will add to our worship service. Elder Lowell Cooper, recently retired as a vice president of the General Conference, is going to be our speaker. And Pastor Cooper is a very spiritual man, a deep thinker, excellent speaker, and I know that you'll find him to be an encouragement to you. So we hope that you'll not only invite people to come, but that you'll come. We need everyone for you here. Next week is not the day to watch the skimming on your television. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing when you can't come. But we hope that you'll be here in person and enjoy this very special day. Starts Friday morning at 10:30. Some of you this morning may have noticed a new billboard out in front of the entrance to the hospital in the past, just east of us on 161. And it's there all shrouded, because we're going to unveil it next Friday morning at 10:30 a.m. And we'll be just pleased if every one of you can come, or as many as possible can come.
Dr. George, 10:30 where? Where? 10:30?
10:30, park in the church parking lot, walk over next door to the step-by-step autism academy, and there we'll be gathered at 10:30 for this special program. Next Friday at 7 p.m. in this room, we'll be showing a film of pictures that go back 100 years. The people that founded the hospital at that time, and then helped to organize this church just in the next couple of years. We'll have pictures, and we'll have a lecture or a presentation, a narrative, and Dr. Richard Harding and I will be leading out in that. At the end of the evening, Dr. Walter Menninger, I don't know if any of you have ever heard of the Menninger Clinic in Kansas. Is there anyone here that's ever heard of it? Boy, a number have. Well, Dr. Menninger is going to be here, and he's going to comment on it at the end of the picture. I think you'll enjoy it. Those that were here for the first church, we had an example of the new blinds that we have on these windows. Now you can see up on the upper level on your right that you don't see any light coming in. Well, this morning we had those all closed on both sides, and it was just as dark as it is at night, and we could see those pictures just as clear as could be. So we're going to have that at 7 o'clock next Friday evening in this auditorium right here. Invite your friends to come. Some of you may have noticed a big sign down on the Worthington Green about our programs, and you'll be seeing more in the newspapers and the television this week. Now, we'll have the regular church at 9 o'clock, and at 11:20, we will have the same program and the same preacher on each one of them, so come to either one that's best with you. We'll appreciate your coming down towards the front so that our guests and visitors that maybe are a little unsure of whether they want to come down front, that they can have those seats back under the balcony. And certainly will be a blessing for all of us, I'm sure. At 10:20, we're going to have stories of the founding of Harding Hospital and the way that God led in opening up the way to found a hospital in Columbus. 100 years ago, the church was a rather small church at that time. And yet, from that small beginning, a hospital grew that today is serving thousands and thousands of people each year. At lunchtime, there'll be lunch, no charge for anybody. Hope you'll all be there. And I might mention that after the dedication of the marker at 10:20 next Friday, we'll have the exhibits open in the Heritage House. And there'll be a light lunch then, and no charge for that either. So bring your friends and come to them. In the afternoon, we'll have a panel discussion on spirituality in our daily lives and in medical treatment. This is something that is an important part of Harding Hospital, and I think you'll find it of interest. It's all going to be finished by 5:30 in the afternoon, and we hope you'll come. Just one item, if any of you would like to take a walking tour around the hospital grounds, we're going to have that available for people that come to the first church during the second church. And that we'll also have it available at 1:45 in the afternoon after the lunch and before we start at 2:30 with the activities. So we ask that you pray for this special weekend, because we do want to remember those that founded this and participated in it, contributed so much, because the relationship between this church and Harding Hospital and Worthington Foods has been a very strong part of what has been accomplished through the years. We want to want to thank the Lord for this, and we want you to come and have a special blessing next Friday and next Sabbath. Thank you very much.
Stand up, front row. Thank you, Dr. Harding. He'll be praying in just a moment. We're going to sing a song, and it's the opening song. So let's stand together. Bob Bradley is here. We're going to play and sing and shout for the Lord on his holy day today. Page number 290 in the hymnal, but you'll be able to read it off the screen. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Stanza. Without the organ. His word will not fail you, he promised. Believe in and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Sing out the chorus now. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full on his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strange. Lead him in the light of his glory and grace.
Beautiful, thank you.
Far as you're able, we invite you to kneel this morning as we as a congregation seek the Lord in prayer. Gracious and good Heavenly Father, we respectfully bow today in your presence and to thank you for fulfilling your promise that where two or three are gathered together, there you will be with us. And this morning, as we gather here, we humbly acknowledge our need for thee. We know that it is so easy to have good wishes, so difficult to fulfill them. We know that we would like to think that we are strong enough that we can earn our way into heaven. But we know that this is only possible through the precious blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. We know that there is nothing we can do but accept, and you will then grant us eternal life. Dear Lord, we remember those who stepped out in faith 100 years ago and decided that they would have an outreach, another outreach, because this was something that characterized the church in Columbus, Ohio. But that this time, that they would follow the words of Ellen White, follow the example of John Harvey Kellogg, follow the model set by Dr. Sutherland and Dr. McGann in the Madison experience, and putting these things together and with a full commitment to you, they stepped out in faith and started the Harding Hospital on September 1, 1916. And though it started small, the kind of service that the nurses gave, the dedication of the physicians, the atmosphere of a Christ-centered place led to many people coming for help, and moves to larger facilities south of Columbus and then to Worthington, where we are thankful that we have been able to live for these many years. Now we pray that you will touch the hearts of many people, encourage them, inspire them to come next week and worship together, to remember and to praise and to look forward to our continued service to our fellow man, to our Lord, and to the soon coming of Jesus Christ. We pray that you will touch each of our hearts here today. Help us to be strong. Help us to be forgiving. Help us to be thankful. And dear Lord, during this week, may we invite others to come. And next week, may we welcome them in a way that will lead some to return to this congregation, that will inspire others to look more fully and know what it is that makes this such a house of prayer and a house of goodness for many people. Now guide us this week. Bless our church. Bless our people worldwide. Bless our nation in this time of elections and conflict. Touch them with your loving hand and your guidance, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before the thank you, Dr. Harding, I appreciate that beautiful prayer. Before our deacons come up, we in our church board meeting, we talked about finances once in a while, and we have a different format, and it's going to be fun. So here we go. I'm 57 years old, and they call me Old School Bob. Now, Julian is much younger, So he's just a young guy to me. Now these young guys, they do things really well, but they do things a little differently when it comes to the computer, okay? Like, my smartphone is run by a dumb person, okay? Why are you laughing? Because some of you know what I'm talking about, right? Now, Julian's a smart guy, and he has a smartphone, but he's smarter than his phone. He's off working on his phone right now. So we're gonna do a skit, okay? I'm gonna talk, he's gonna do the skits. Bring your phone up here, please. This is the offertory today. No, you gotta bring your phone up here. Yes, yeah, that's right. Oh, here we go. No. Old guy, young guy. Old guy, no computer, smartphone, and car, doesn't care about smartphone. Smart guy, bigger than a smartphone, iPad. That's really smart. Now, Julian, now we have people in this church that are like me and they're like you with this. Doesn't mean you're not a good person or a bad person, just you do things differently. So the old ways are tie the envelope, you pull it out, right? You write it in there, and we beg for money all year long, and then you understand that. But the new way, he's going to tell you about what he does. And all those people understand what he does on here is what we're going to say to the people on TV, because today you can give right now online. We never do this, do we? So Julian, what do people that are in your age bracket do with the app situation? I can't even explain this to them, but I know you are going to look in the camera, and then you guys listen up so you can tell your neighbor's friends.
Well, friends, I understand that we live in a different time and age. My wife and I, we teach the young adults, and I know that they don't carry cash or these old checkbooks, but everybody has the smartphone. And so today, if you're watching us online, you can just go at worthingtonsda.org, and right there on the homepage, you'll see the big button Give. And if you have a mobile phone right now, the app is going to look exactly like what you see on the screen. You click over there on Give, and you can just place your donation quick and easy and secure. It's a 256-bit secure servers, so your donation is saved there. Nobody's going to know about your information. So thank you very much for supporting the work of God. For those of you who are watching us online around the world, I get emails from India, from China, from different places, from Russia, people watching us, and they are blessed. If you feel prompted right now as you're watching us online, you can just go at worthingtonsda.org and click Give. We appreciate your gift. Thank you.
Now, I'm going to tell you that when the homeless people come to this church, they don't go to him because he does everything online. I'm the one with the checkbook and the cash. So remember that. And then when you come to me and I only give you a dollar, don't be mad, because I'm giving dollars to other people too. This is a smarter way. I think I'm going to get into this way. Thank you, Julian, so much. Oh yeah. May the deacons please come forward. Come on, we did that pretty well, didn't we? Amen. How many of you have ever used the app? You raise your hand. Just look at that, Julian. Lots of people in the balcony too. Pretty soon we're going to be like the elections, and we're going to say people that had this much school or did this, did that. That it takes so long, though. Doesn't it take long? But these are really the young. There's the youngest deacon of all, right over there. Lord, thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. Thank you for Thomas Bartlett coming back 37 years later. Oh, my word. Wonderful. There's other people that can come back, too. May we be open. May we be open to receiving people. Not as judgmental people, but as people that want the family to be complete. When we go to our family reunion, we should be calling, emailing, texting, whatever, old school, new school, any way we can do it. Because the good food that grandma makes, or auntie makes, or mommy makes, it's going to be the food of the table that you make for us that we'll be eating forever and ever and ever. Now, the offering is taken today, and some people go into their smartphones, and other people go into their checkbooks and their wallets. Whatever way that is, may it be a way that will bring honor to your name, honor and glory forever. Amen. And amen. Thank you.
Good morning, church, and happy Sabbath. I'd like you to pray with me as I minister the song. Was paralyzed by fear when they heard a mighty multitude was quickly drawing near. But as they prayed for deliverance, the victory would begin. For when we call upon the Lord, we summon all of heaven. Pray on, for you those mighty strongholds down. Stay on your knees, for this is where the battle is won. Very soon you'll win the victory. Pray on. When Daniel faced the lions for worshiping the Lord, it would seem there was no hope at all for what would be in store. But when we stand on holy ground, the smallest prayer is heard. Instead of on our circumstance, our eyes are on the Lord. Pray on, for you. Your prayers may seem in vain. It may seem to make no difference. It would seem to make no change. Just rest assured, God knows your needs, and He hears each time you pray. Your prayers are reaching heaven, and the answer's on the way.
She is not only the secretary of our church, but as you can hear, she is a beautiful voice that introduces in powerful way my sermons. For those of you who are new here among us, my name is Pastor Julian. I have the privilege to be the lead pastor and teaching pastor of Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. And yet, these are titles. I do hope and I do pray and I do believe that Jesus himself is the lead pastor of this church and he is the teaching pastor of this church, and I just humbly invite him to bless you today, to bless you now, and as I open my Bible and as you open your Bible, I pray that he lead us both, us all, so that we can understand his word, we can apply it in our lives, and glorify him. With that said, let me begin my message today with a statement that may outrage some of you here. And here it goes. People's attitude toward money, toward possessions, is one of the most reliable way of gauging their spiritual condition. I know it sounds strange, it sounds heretical, but I will let Jesus tell you this time and again during this sermon. And he's going to do it better than me. But this is what I've discovered through the scriptures. Stingy people make very lousy Christians. Did you know that in the Bible there are only 500 verses talking about faith? 500, that's it. Did you know that there are less than 500 verses in the Bible talking about prayer, as important prayer is? But there are over 2,000 verses in the Holy Scriptures that talk about money and possession. Did you know that almost half of Jesus' parables deal with possessions and money? Did you know that in the heart of Jesus' very first sermon, the Sermon on the Mount, right in the heart of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus talks about money and possessions? Why is that? Why is God so interested in our money? Okay. Someone knows his Bible. Good. Because Jesus knows that how we related to money will influence our relationship with him. With that said, I would like today to preach from the first sermon of Jesus, the Sermon on the Mount. And I made a pun. I just took this Sermon on the Mount and I just retitled it. Today I would like to present to you spiritual jewels from the Sermon on the Mount. Not the Mount, a Mount. So, okay. So today I would like to present three spiritual jewels from Jesus' first sermon. Would you like to hear them? After you heard the introduction, nope, don't preach to me, because I know you're going to ask me to open my wallet. Okay, no, I'm not going to ask you anything, but Jesus may. Would you please open your Bibles with me to the Gospel of Matthew? You have Bibles right in front of you, so you can pick up a Bible. And it's the first book of the New Testament. And for those of you who have your electronic devices, I hope you have not just Facebook, but you have also the book installed on your device. You can follow me, go to Matthew chapter 6, and I would like to invite someone to read for us verses 19 through 21. And Bob Bradley is going to be here to assist you. He's going to come to you with a microphone so that we can hear your voice. Thank you, Dr. Obi Conley. We're going to hear Francis reading for us verses 19 through 21 of chapter 6 of the Gospel of Matthew.
Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be.
Well, Jesus speaking here about about money. And the first thing that Jesus tells us is possessions, money including, are gonna fail you. If you do not suffer by flood, and flood destroys your home and your belongings, maybe bankruptcy is gonna come in your life, or maybe you're gonna be unemployed, but finances and possessions are gonna fail you, Jesus says. And if money do not fail you today or tomorrow, or even 50 years from tomorrow, one day, money will be gone and you're gonna be gone away from your money, because we all have come empty-handed in this world, and this is how we're gonna leave out of this world. Don't fool yourself. You're not gonna carry in the grave with you all the belongings and all the possessions and all the things that you treasure in this world. Therefore, Jesus says, change your bank. I know some of you say, oh, I'm with Citi. They are the mightiest bank ever. I'm with Chase, or I'm with Fifth Third. Let me tell you what Jesus is calling you and me today, no matter which bank you have invested your money and your portfolio in, he says, change your bank. And before I talk to which bank should be changed to and what currency we should invest in, I would like to tell you why Jesus asked us, the most important reason why Jesus asked us to change our banks. The first reason was because possessions are gonna fail us. Possessions and money are gonna fail us. But there is a more important reason why Jesus asked us to change our banks. Jesus says in verse 21, for where your treasure is, what's gonna happen? Your heart is gonna follow. Your heart follows your treasure. Jesus outlines here and underlines here one of the most important principles in life. We give money for the things we treasure. We spend money on people or things that we value. And if we spend money only on ourselves or only on our immediate family, guess what? The only person that you're gonna treasure, the only people that you're gonna love are those people to whom you give or spend money for. That's it. Because Jesus says that he needs not your money, he needs your heart. All this talk in the Bible about money is not because God is possessed about money and he's so into your financial business. God knows one thing, that our hearts are where our treasures are. And Jesus is after our hearts. But if your heart, if my heart is in my bank account and my business portfolio, guess what? Jesus knows that he will never have my heart. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Jesus is after our hearts. Many Christians say, well, the pastor, I'll have two treasures. One here on earth, I'll have my portfolio, business portfolio, I'll have my bank accounts, I'll have my investments in the stock exchange, and I'll invest also in Jesus. Do you know what? You have only one heart. And you cannot divide your heart. Sooner or later, your heart is gonna gravitate toward your biggest treasure. You cannot divide your heart. This is why Jesus tells us the first jewel on how to manage spiritual life: have a single treasure, just one treasure. And Jesus says, let this treasure better be located in heaven, where thieves do not steal, where moth and rust cannot destroy. Have a single treasure, because you cannot have two treasures. Your heart is going to be split. Now let's move to the second jewel from the Sermon on the Mount. So Matthew chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. Would you please shoot your hand up? Let's hear the word of God. On this side above, we have several people, so you choose, Bob. It's up to you. You guys lift up your hands so that Bob can see you. So Matthew chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. The same sermon, the same context. Let's hear what Jesus is about to tell us.
The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness?
Jesus is very mystical here, don't you think? If your eye is good, you'll be full of light. What does he mean? What is he trying to say? Good. Jesus says in verse 22, if therefore your eye is good, your whole being, your whole body will be full of light. I would like to talk about this word translated in our Bibles as good, which, sorry to disappoint you, but it's not exact. I mean, this is New King James. They have messed up a little bit. The word that is used here is the Greek word haplos. And haplos, as many words, is a multivalency word. That means it has many meanings. And I'm going to emphasize two of these meanings. The root of the word haplos is closely related to the word for generosity. And if you don't believe me, when you go home, open your Greek Bible, and you can check Romans 12, verse 8, 2 Corinthians, James, and other verses. So, the first meaning is generosity. Basically, what Jesus tells us, people who are not generous, they're full of darkness. Did you hear that? People who are stingy are full of darkness. Do you understand why Jesus is targeting our wallets? Not because he needs your money. He needs you to be light. And he knows that people who are stingy are full of darkness. The amount of our love for God is shown in our support of his kingdom. I told you, you give for what you love and what you cherish. If the only person you give to is yourself, if you only sponsor yourself or just the close people around you, guess what? You may talk about how much you love God. You may fool some people around you, but God is not fooled. God looks at you with pity because he knows we have become slaves of the darkness, because Scrooge type of people, stingy people, are dark inside people. The second reason, the second meaning I would like to give you to the word haplos, translated in some of our Bibles with good, actually is very well translated in King James in this case. King James does not do always exceptionally good job, but in this case, very good job. The other meaning of haplos is closely related to the immediate context. I told you that the word haplos has many meanings. How do you know which of the meanings is actually the main meaning of the text? Easy. You go into the context. You see what the passage around talks about, and this is how you determine. Do you remember what Jesus was talking about in the previous three verses? To have what? What kind of treasure? Single treasure. One treasure. The word haplos, the main meaning of the word haplos is single. So he says here, therefore, if your eye is single, you're going to be full of light. Otherwise, if your eye is not single, you're going to be full of darkness. And you say, what does single eye mean? What is Jesus trying to say? Well, back in these days, a single eye, single focused eye meant healthy eye. People who simultaneously were focusing on two or more objects were called crossed eye. So single eye means healthy eye. If your spiritual eye, Jesus says, is healthy, if it's focused only on one subject, then you're going to be full of life. Otherwise, you have treasures here, you have treasures there, you're full of darkness. Now, I promise that we are going to talk about the bank in which to invest and what currency should we use. Some people say, oh, invest in diamonds or invest in gold. What does Jesus say? Would you like to hear it? Okay. In one of his parables, Jesus says, and I say to you, make friends for yourselves by the unrighteous mammon. Mammon is an Aramaic word for money. Yeah. Mammon means money. Make yourself friends, actually the Greek word philos, friends, means those who love you, those who like you. Make people to love you and to like you. By what means? Through the unrighteous money. Money by itself is not righteous. But if you invest it in a righteous person, in a righteous meaning and way, they can become righteous meaning. And he says then that when it may fail you, is this what he says? When the mammon, when money may fail you. What does Jesus say? When it fails you. Which Jesus knows, and we better learn that, money and possession will ultimately fail you one day. And he says, make friends now with the money that I have given you. Make spiritual friends so that one day when possession fail you, they may receive you into an everlasting home. What Jesus is saying here is that life is an opportunity to invest in people, to love people, to make friends, and to make them friends of Jesus. If you think that life has any other purpose, you're delusional, Jesus says. Because any other thing you invest your money, your time, your education, your efforts in, ultimately is going to fail you. The only thing that is not going to fail you is investing your money and time and opportunities in loving people, making them your friends, and making them ultimately friends of Jesus. Because the currency of heaven is people. We human beings use people and treasure things. God, on the other hand, treasures people and only uses things. So he tells us, invest in people. For God so loved the world that he did what? He took. He took or he gave? Anyone who loves gives. Stingy people take. For God so loved the world that he gave. He gave the ultimate prize for you and me. He gave the ultimate prize for every human being. And he says, you're wasting my resources. You're wasting your life. You're wasting your education. You're wasting your good looks. You're wasting your skills. You're wasting everything unless you are investing in my treasure, Jesus says, and my treasure are people. So, on behalf of God, I would like to challenge you. Start investing in people. And yes, start with your family. Start with your children and grandchildren. Give them the best Christian education that money can buy. Give them the best opportunities in life so that they can succeed. But above all, become their friend and make them friends of Jesus. Anything else will fail. Jesus is not going to fail. And here is the second jewel from the Sermon on the Mount. And the second jewel is, have a single vision, and let it be the vision of Christ. Let it be the vision of salvation of people. Invest in people, love people. Make them your friends, and make them ultimately friends of Jesus. And now let's finish up the jewels for today with verse 24. Who would like to read for us verse 24? Bob, turn around, lift up your hand high. Do you see her? You pass her by, and she was disappointed that you didn't stop by her side. She wanted so badly to read. Thank you. Let's hear Matthew 6, 24.
You cannot serve God and riches. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon.
Amen. Listen, friends, God is not against money. But God is against money becoming your master. And listen to that. You may think, oh, I can master money. There is only one way you can master money. Hear the way. You either serve Jesus, and as a result, you master money. Or you else are becoming slave of money, and money are mastering you. Forget about this thing, I'm managing money. You can manage money and you can master money only if Jesus is master of your life. And only if you are investing in the bank that will never fail. Otherwise, you may tell yourself whatever you want, but you are just a slave of your possessions. God is not against you having money. Let's not misunderstand that. Some of the most successful men in the Bible and some of the most spiritual men in the Bible and women in the Bible were rich people, like Father Abraham. Many sheep and many servants, very rich. But the moment you allow your possessions to manage your life and to become subservient to them, be very mindful, because possessions of dreadful master. So here is the third and last jewel for today. Have a single master. And it better be Jesus. Because money, a good servant. Money serves very well. Money can help for education. Money can help pay medical bills. Money can help pay for the homeless and for the poor and lift them up and give them future and hope. But the moment you start hoarding them and they become the purpose of your life, money, a horrible master. I would like us to finish up with this story. I hope it's going to drive my point home. There is a story about how people in India used to catch monkeys. Someone along the way, many, many years ago, capitalized in his hunting of monkeys on one particular characteristics of monkeys. Monkeys are very selfish creatures. So what he did, he took a coconut and carved a hole big enough for the monkey to put his hand inside of the hole. And then in the coconut, he put some nuts. And then he drilled a small hole on the other end of the coconut, put a rope, and he hid himself behind the trees of the jungle and left the coconut with the treats on the way of the monkey. And when the monkey sniffed the treats, it wriggled its little hand inside and grabbed the nuts. But once it tightened his fist, guess what happened? Couldn't get his little hand out of the coconut. And from here, the job of the hunter was done. The only thing he had to do is just to yank the other end of the cord and wriggle in the coconut, kid, and monkey and caboodle. And you'll say, wait a minute, something does not add up. The little monkey can just get his hand out of there and run, right? Logical, right? Well, here is the thing. Do you remember what I told you in the beginning? Monkeys are what kind of creatures? Selfish. So the monkey has this little treasure and clench its little fist around this little treasure and does not want to let go. And becomes a captive or a dinner. If you and I were watching from the edge of the jungle, this probably would have shouted to this monkey, you stupid monkey, just release this little treasure. It's not worth your life. And run. And it's so easy to judge the little stupid monkey. Yet, in our corner of the world, we are doing exactly the same. And Satan is sneaking and waiting from the trees in the jungle and catching us one by one, like little stupid monkeys who are tight fist holding on our little treasures. And I hear people in the church and outside of the church telling me, all this thing about tithes and offerings, this is from the Old Testament. Like God is suffering from bipolar disorder. In the Old Testament, he wanted something. In the New Testament, he does not want it. In the Old Testament, we were selfish. But suddenly in the New Testament, we are full of grace and we are full of generosity. Guess what? This thing about tithes and offerings and this annoying offering plate that passes by is only a reminder for us to unclutch our fists and to learn giving, because otherwise we are going to become dinner and prey of the enemy. So friends, today Jesus is standing in front of us and he's asking us, begging us, would you please give me your heart? What would you say to Jesus? If Jesus stood here today and comes to you and personally asks you, would you give me your heart? What are you going to tell him? Nope. I know what you're going to ask me, the heart. I'm not giving you my heart, right? Let me tell you, friends. Jesus is asking for our hearts. He's after our hearts. But he knows that for many of us, our hearts are hidden in our wallets. So this is why he will also ask you for your wallet. Not for 10% of your wallet, for the whole wallet. Yes, he'll expect you to give back to him the 10% and the offering, whatever you decide to give. But he'll ask you to become master of your whole wallet. Because otherwise, your wallet is going to master you. Would you please join me and take out of your bulletin this yellow connection card. You have one of these yellow connection cards in the bulletin. Just take it out. Looks like that. Take it out. I hope by now you've put at least your name on the front. And I would like to ask you to turn it on the back. You ask, what are these connection cards for? Well, if you are so gracious and give it back to me, what I do with these connection cards, I pray over them. I see your name. I see your prayer request, or I just see your decisions, what you've marked here, and I pray for you. So here today, I would like to suggest to make at least one of these decisions on the back. I'm going to read it for you. First, Lord Jesus, help me to make you my only treasure and all other blessings to become just the means for advancing your kingdom. Education, children, spouse, Money, house, let them become only the means, a stepping stones of making friends who are going to become friends of Jesus. But do not allow these things to become your treasure. Second, I want to have the heart of Jesus, loving people and using things, and not using people and loving things. And finally, my Lord Jesus is the master of my life. And of what? What did this crazy pastor put here? Master of what else also? Of my wallet. Do you have the guts to check this one? My Lord Jesus Christ is a master of my life and including of my wallet. And I will not let anyone or anything, including my wallet, replace him. May God bless you in your decision making.
Closing hymn 330, would you stand with me? Take my life and let it be. Everyone with me on the first stanza. Take my life and
Heavenly Father, what kind of outrageous message this one was, yet so true. And you are concerned about our finances not because you want to have control over our finances, but because you want to have control over our hearts. And unfortunately, it does not go other way, except we give you and grant you control over every single area of our lives, including the most sensitive part of our human system, our pocket and our wallet. So today, Lord, We would like to commit ourselves completely to you. We would like to have this single vision that you have for us, that you have for humanity, that we would like to invest ourselves, our resources, our money, and everything you've given us, so that we can make friends of the kingdom of heaven. Would you please bless each one who was here listening to this message? And yes, I know, today some people were comforted and other people were disturbed, and it's okay. Because I know that you needed to rattle some of us, and you needed also to comfort some of us. As you minister to our hearts today, Lord, would you please help us to love you more, help us to trust you, and help us to completely rest in your divine hands. In the name of your Son, we pray. And all the people said together, Amen.